revenues start to really pop up as well.
I'm going to add on to that. I agree with that 100%. I'm going to add on to that is, you know, I was talking with, I think, someone that many here know with respect to technology and technology development. I know, Nancy, you do. Vinod Khosla and his opinions about the appropriateness of certain technologies over others. I think in this particular instance, it was thin film versus crystalline solutions. Our perspective, being technology agnostic, is that every technology has a role. We can go into that, but I don't need to. What I will say is that the dirty little secret about our solar economy is that there's a lot of cost involved in the balance of systems. We call it BOS. And I think with respect to everything we've heard during this conference having to do with batteries and other things, we see the biggest efficiency gains being made in these future years, if not this coming year, in lowering the cost of the balance of systems. When you add that to the declining price of technologies, either crystalline or thin film, it doesn't really matter. The fact is that installed systems in this country are going to be very low priced and are really approaching a point where it just makes fundamental sense. I mean, invest in solar is the point. I mean, it's going to be a good one.
Ed, could you maybe discuss the financeability of crystalline versus thin film panels, and then maybe PV versus CSP, and
can I just address that
sure.
other question first? And you asked about, you know, where is it and when is it that we can afford to strand depreciation benefits, basically, because we're able to convert an ITC into a cash grant, assuming the government can get some rules out. The answer is that under most structures, the depreciation is worth about 8% of purchase price. So if you can forego that 8% of purchase price, you can strand the depreciation, you know, and still get a yield. So that's really a very direct answer. As far as the different kinds of technology, we value thin film differently than we value PV. It has different degradation rates. It has different residual values, or at least perceived residual values. So they are different in how they're financed and the terms that they're financed under and the length of the terms that they're financed.
Nancy, so. You've invested in CSP, thin film, and crystalline, I believe, over the years. Could you discuss, you know, what goes into your thought process there and how do you assess technology risk?
Well, we're obviously bullish on solar. We're doing all of the categories and really feel that all solar innovation is necessary to meet the climate change goals we have and the insatiable appetite we have for energy, especially as we get electrics on the road. That's going to be a huge increase in demand for electricity. So we have to kind of think into the future, and that's why we're placing our bets across the board. They're very different markets. It's very, you know, it's always fun for venture capitalists to kind of say which technology is going to win, but it's fairly perilous as well. And I would just say that the thin film world, you know, if you look at the homeowner, and you know, it's admittedly it's not the commercial market, but it's a big thriving market that we should all be tapping into. You wouldn't expect this in terms of, because we know it's less efficient, but a lot of homeowners prefer the aesthetics of thin film panels to PV. And aesthetics is a huge part of the future. You know, improving aesthetics for solar is one of the areas we're looking at in terms of new approaches and new systems, because as we were talking about, the costs are going down. Think about the iPhone and the phenomenal success design and functionality has brought to Apple as compared to, you know, the first generation of cell phones out there. You know, that's where solar has to move to. You know, we're not going to have these, you know, for a lot of the market, they don't care what it looks like, but believe me, increasingly you're seeing a more demanding public in terms of aesthetics. And so thin films, who knew that people would like the way they looked better when they were being developed? That wasn't on anyone's design screen.
Maybe for Nick and Sanjay, how are investors viewing technology risk right now, and do you think that's priced into the stocks?
I think it's case-by-case basis, right? Before I go to that, though, one point I do want to make about the grid parity, if I may. I think the industry needs to properly define what grid parity is, because I think we often get lost in this point that solar has to be competitive on a grid parity basis. But if you take into consideration peak power prices in Texas last year, it was 25 to 30 cents a kilowatt hour. Solar is competitive on that basis, right? And I think solar is an ideal peak power solution. It's not competing with wind at this point in time. So I think overall, when industry is interacting with the utilities, you know, who they should view their partners on a long-term basis, I think the sales pitch has to be very strong versus, and I'm not trying to say that it's not, but I think it could be stronger because there's a value prop that this industry brings to the table. I don't think is fully being realized, appreciated as to what that is, because I think it gives utilities a hedge. Correct me if I'm wrong. I think it's got a phenomenal load curve. I think it's predictable, 20-year. Data is there. You can evaluate it. So I think this industry just had a phenomenal long-term potential on that basis as well. And in some cases, we're already cost competitive. We don't even need to come down the cost curve further. Coming down the cost curve further will only help. So going back to your point about the investor sentiment, obviously, First Solar, I think, is everybody's already found a lottery ticket. They've done a phenomenal job, and the company's done a fantastic job. So clearly, the multiple is much higher on those guys. But I think there is a level of skepticism on some of the other thin film companies, but most of them are really in the private domain. And for the Crystal and PV, I think there is some disparity between the folks that are based here in the U.S. versus the ones that are in China, given, I think, partly because lack of transparency in some cases. But at this point in time, based on the available data, First Solar execution gets high premium. Some of the other Crystal and PV companies in U.S. tend to get a high premium, especially one that has a huge utility presence and then followed by some of the leading players out of Asia. Is that fair?
And it's really a question, a multi-pronged question. I mean, it's about how much technology risk one is taking, it's about the bankability of the project, and it's about the balance sheet of the company behind it. So you're going to have a varying degree of investor sentiment for, you know, a company that checks off two of those boxes versus one that checks off three. I mean, this question of bankability is increasingly important. I mean, we were all discussing it backstage, but, you know, now lenders have the pick of their litter when it comes to project finance, and really they're going to take less technology risk than they would have when credit was free flowing. So, you know, something that could have been financed maybe 2 years ago, a, you know, new startup SIGS film maybe, might have more trouble in this environment than they would in the past. So those questions are coming up a lot more than they had been a year or a year and a half ago.
I'd like to add that, I mean, that's exactly right. It all boils down to the underwriting, and in a market, in a tight market, for whatever reason, you know, we look through to the balance sheets of the companies that we work with, both in terms of the customer side, but also in terms of on the technology side. We're looking at promises. We're looking at performance guarantees for projects, product warranties, guarantees, and that's an interesting area where industry could and is working closely with those that are, you know, financing, building, owning, and operating these projects, working together to help educate capital markets to the extent that they need to get, remember, single-digit money coming into these projects over, you know, a long period of time. And simply put, in this market, and just to iterate what you said, we have a situation right now where commercial customers that we're working to do business with, can't qualify now because they're not investment grade, in that the contracts they sign, a 20-year PPA, are looked at as if they were corporate bonds being issued by the same company. And no one in the capital markets is buying 20-year bonds from companies that may not be around for a long time, and that's unfortunately the common perspective.
Mark, how does PSE&G?